It's easier for us to play against the best teams, like against SK or Alliance, then they're much ahead in win streaks and they don't consider us a strong team, and then they're making mistakes and we're catching them on those mistakes and just finishing the game. So that's not going to happen against Millennium, I think, so it's going to be about our pure skill.
Welcome back to our continuing coverage of this Super Week 7 in the European LCS. I'm Joe Miller, along with Martin DeFisciolinger, as we head into our next match between Millennium and Gambit Gaming. Now, yesterday we saw Millennium take on Fnatic, and then went with something other than their most successful pick comp setup. However, it was kind of hard to see what they were really aiming for with that comp.
Yeah, it was a very weird comp for Millennium. I mean, they had a few different ideas with it, I guess. That Kha'Zix's jungle building full damage, and then that Kraton on Tristana as being their hyper carry. The issue was that Curb on Lulu, a very passive mid laner, which is something that really doesn't favor Curb and Millennium as a team. And also they had, of course, Jhirri on Morgana. So they had the Black Shield and the Wild Growth to either protect the Tristana or the Kha'Zix, but they couldn't do both. So it ended up being some very weird team fights, and they looked very passive, and actually they looked lost, because they never really did anything. And they lost 4 out of 5 Dragons as well to Fnatic, who just picked up the win fairly easily.
Yeah, but earlier today, they were beaten by Rockat's late game comp with Ryze and Jax, but the game did get off to a good start for Millennium.
Yeah, so they had a good start, but then they started playing passive again, and they danced around this Baron for about 10 minutes, just giving Rockat time to outscale them, and going just for this late game point where Millennium weren't able to teamfight, and they lost the map from there on, lost the teamfights, and it's just been an issue for Millennium. They play very passive. If things isn't exactly working 100% like the way they wanted to, and therefore they don't know what to do and just end up losing the game.
Well, on the other side of the Rift, Gambit took on SK Gaming yesterday and were completely outclassed in that one. They didn't really seem to have much to say in that defeat.
No, they lost on 29 minutes and 10 seconds to SK Gaming, and they were, as you just said, they were simply outclassed. There was nothing they could do. They lost the lane swap early on, and from there on they just lost every single team fight. They did a weird thing where they banned Lucian, but then didn't early pick Caitlyn for Genji, which I thought was the idea behind the Lucian ban. Instead, they actually picked Twitch for Genji at champion, which of course he can play, but doesn't seem to favor his style too much, where you have to walk around, make some risky plays, set up some ganks, and he never really got going in the game here. And we of course also had some uncoordinated team fights from Gambit with their Wombo combo a little bit. It didn't work for them. I do have to give some credit to Darien, though, up in the top lane. I called him out yesterday for dying too much. He actually went 2-1-0 on Jax, and he picked up a lot of towers and some kills as well to try and help the team win, but it just wasn't enough. So credit to Darien. He played really well yesterday.
And here are the starting lineups for our two teams today. On the blue side for Millennium, we have Kevin in the top lane, Connex in the jungle, Kerp in the middle, and the duo of Kreaton and Jhirri.
And on the red side, we have Gambit Gaming with Darien in the top lane, Diamond in the jungle, Nick as the mid laner, Genji as the AD carry, and of course, Edward on support.
And of course, you guys have been letting us know which teams you think are going to win, so let's see how this one added up. According to LOLESports.com, you've gone for Millennium with 63% of the vote.
So if Gambit Gaming picks a late game comp and Millennium plays as passive they've done in the last two games, I think actually Gambit Gaming is going to take it.
Well, we're going to find out here shortly as we head towards Champions. Like you mentioned yesterday, that they ended up banning out AD carries, but maybe following a route which you didn't expect there. Where do you think the focus is going to lie in this game? Surely something aimed towards Kerp, as most teams are doing against Millennium.
Often we see a lot of focus on taking the assassins away from Kerb, and I actually do have to correct myself, because I said Gambit banned Lucian. It was SK Gaming who banned it against Gambit Gaming. So, small mistake on my part here. Still, they could have early picked Caitlyn here. Not sure if Gambit will target Kerb. They could ban away something like his Fizz, maybe his Twisted Fate, if they don't feel like they can deal with it. And on the side of Millennium, I could see them ban away Kale, because they banned it twice already this week.
And probably going to be banning out Kassadin. I mean, they are the blue side for this one, and they've been banning Kassadin on the blue side as well. So we'll see about that as we get in. We can see already, first ban coming out for Millennium will in fact be Kale. And we've seen time and time again that when a Kale gets rolling, it can be very, very hard to stop. For Gambit then, onto their first ban, actually going to take Jhirri, or go towards Jhirri with their first ban, and remove Morgana from the game, along with then Twisted Fate. On Millennium side, they took away Evelynn from Diamond.
So some expected bans, of course, Kassadin from Millennium, always on the blue side. They keep banning it away because they know the other teams won't ban against Millennium. and of course the Kale don't want to risk this late game monster when you tend to play these passive and long, long games. And of course Gambit targets towards Kerb. Twisted Fate is the one that really stands out.
Ziggs, also a big favorite of Kerb. And Kassadin, blue side ban for Millennium once again. That left Lee Sin up, which will be picked in. And Cortanex has done really, really well with Lee Sin.
So they banned away Evelynn, which has been the go-to jungler for Diamond whenever Lee Sin was an Oppie. And then they first pick Lee Sin. Should, however, mean Diamond can just pick Elise whenever he actually wants to and secure an equally strong jungler as Lee Sin, in my opinion. And of course, we do get Lucian onto Genji, his favorite AD carry. And just all around, such a great AD carry pick here, and a good start for both teams.
Will they be locking in that Lulu as well? It certainly looks like they will. And we're going to see that, I'd say most probably going into the middle lane there for Nick, although with it being a first pick, Lulu could still end up being in the top lane, but not really a champion that we generally associate with Darien on the top side of the map.
Very true. He did play some Kale up in the top lane, so might have picked up Lulu as well. I mean, she is a very good top laner, even if you fall behind, because she brings so much utility to your team. So you can go 0-5 on her and still go into team fights and do a very good job here. So could be a champion for Darien. Not a champion he can split push on, however, but if he wants to become the split pusher where he drags a lot of attention to the top lane, which he normally likes to do.
So for Millennium then, what are they going to go with? Jax open and left available. And Kevin himself, who honestly has been playing really, really solidly for Millennium and pretty much seems to have always been a solid player across the board. He will be taking Jax this time.
Always consistent. Will always do well early on. Will always have a big impact later on in game as well. So he's good in team fights and his laning phase is pretty solid as well. And he's a smart player. He knows what to play, what to build here. So just a very consistent player. And of course, Jax, slightly weaker early game with the changes to lifesteal, but still a very, very strong pick unless teams manage to punish him early on, which we actually often see, where teams will lane swap against this Jax here, shut him down early, and then just keep denying him farm and therefore delay his whole Trinity Force Blade of Ruined King power spike and just be a lot stronger for the first 30-40 minutes until Jax gets his items. And if you don't close out the game by that time, obviously everything has gone to waste. But still, if you can manage to close it out, you will pretty much make Jax a non-factor.
So Lee Sin was already taken away here for the jungle by Millennium. We've got Thresh locked in for Edward, the champion, which back to power with. And it looks like we are going to be seeing Skarner locked in for Diamond in the jungle. I know the exact date when he last played Skarner, February the 14th of this year, in fact.
And back then, Skarner was a little bit different.
Yes.
Some changes. Most important is his passive now. Whenever he uses his abilities, he will stack it up when you get to 3 stacks. If you auto-attack the target, you will actually stun it. Early on, it's only for half a second, however, but still, it's a stun, lock down a target, then you grab it with your ulti and you drag it into the team here. And the cool thing Gambit Gaming can do is you have Lulu and Skarner together, so Lulu speeds up Skarner, he speeds up himself as well, and you just rush towards the target. And if there's no flash or no jump on the target he goes towards, he will be able to grab them and pull them into the team.
Well, Millennium finished off their team comp, taking Fizz in the mid lane for Kerb. And again, that's the Kerb on Fizz has really, I guess, personified the form that Millennium have had. Either a brilliant game or a terrible game with Fizz. We'll see how he does today. But with Leona as well, this is a kind of combination that Millennium have done well with in the past.
It's such a dive-in comp here. They can pick off people, especially with Leona and Fizz together here, and Lee Sin joining in. But also in team fights, they're just looking for everyone to pile onto the back line of Gambit. And then you just leave Kraton by himself in the back and say, you know what, you can just survive by yourself, do all the damage you can do, and then get away. The rest of us, we just dive onto Gambit Gaming here and try and kill some of the squishies in the back line. So Millennium with a very aggressive comp, and definitely a comp where they need to start get rolling here, because Fizz in this mid lane, it's very important he gets a good start. Otherwise, he won't be able to do enough in these team fights. Or if he wants to split push later on, together with the Jax, we have 1-3-1. Fizz again needs a very good start in the lane.
See how he does here against Nick's Lulu, champion which he's gone for quite a few times before. Now, Fizz, we don't all that often see picked into a Lulu who, you know, used to be definitely a champion which you just lose flat out in lane to. Now,
used
not
to
quite
be.
The case.
Yeah, used to be, of course, with the Q changes, we keep talking about them. I can see your smile on your face. You really wanted to talk about it here. But of course, with the Q changes, no longer the same lane bully.
Yeah.
Still, should be able to do a lot of damage onto the Fizz here, but Kerb with Flask, most likely it's his first item. will just look to farm away first, get some items going, get his Lich Bane, and then we might see him start split pushing or looking for small fights here with the rest of Millennium, trying to pick up people left and right.
Well, with the picks and bans locked in, who came out on top in your opinion? Tweet hashtag MILWin or hashtag GMBWin to at LOL Esports, and we'll check on the results shortly from this one. And as you mentioned there, the Flask, something that Kerr often takes into matches in that mid lane where he's expecting a lot of pressure and a lot of damage out of his opposition to keep the sustain up in his lane.
Also because he plays very aggressive, he often goes in to trade some damage just to get farm afterwards to push the enemy away from the minions, get the farm, take a lot of damage in return, then he needs the flash to sustain back up here, and it's just a place that he likes to use. But we have to say here, Gammy Gaming, they need to be careful late game because Millennium are scaling really well.
Well, we are going to head into game and figure out how this one is going to go down. It's Millennium versus Gambit, and wins for both of these teams would be a welcome sign at this stage of things. That game earlier on against Rocket for Millennium was probably a tough one to swallow considering the good start that they had, and then, as you said, got into a bit more of a passive mode and allowed Rockout to scale themselves into a prime position to go on and win that one. We'll see here if anything happens in the early stages of the game. Up until now, see that both teams pretty much identically spread out across the map.
And I want to see if Cotnex is looking to be aggressive towards Diamond here early on. Skarner is actually good enough in the early game. He should be able to at least avoid dying if Cotnex finds him out of camp here, because he has the speed of, he has the slow, of course, with his E, he can even stun Cotnex and then escape. Mm. And Skarner is not bad in the early game. I mean, he can farm really well as a fast jungler, and his ganks are okay. Even before 6, he can actually go and begin, because he provides both a stun and a slow now, and he can speed himself up. He has a lot of tools to use, and I want to see these engages from Gambit. If it is speeding up Diamond, goes towards whatever target he can get to, uses his ulti and just pour them back into the team here. Late game, Skarner always has the issue that teams tend to itemize against him. Like Quicksilver Sash, of course, worked perfectly against Skarner. Banshees will work too if he can't break it before he gets into the target. So there's a lot of items against him late game, which is another issue for Gambit, of course.
So we saw Genja there risking things as the vote comes in 68% in favor of Gambit. So that's pretty much a 100% swing from what we saw from the LOLesports.com vote earlier on, where you put Millennium in the favorite seat, if you like, to win this encounter. But Gambit with that team comp, we'll see how they do. And there we see Edward actually just going to walk straight into the brush. Oh, that means a lot Edward. Of damage early on. And he's down to about a quarter of his health, just because of the fact that he's walked straight into that brush without even checking it out. And there's Kevin as well, going aggressive on Darien right at the start.
Yeah, in this game again, early game, it's really going to rely on Millennium trying to survive both solo lanes, where Gambit should be stronger and should be able to pressure Millennium a lot down this bottom lane here. Edward, of course, had to use a potion early on. Can sustain a little bit with his Relic Shield if he gets the last hit. But not a very good start for him, just face checking into Leona. Managed though, because he's still level 1, just auto attack trade on the melee champion Leona is.
Yeah, I was going to say, pretty much equaled out that damage up until this point, so that's all good for him. We should also mention that we are on 4.10, because Skarner obviously has had a few of his numbers tweaked and lowered in the 4.11 patch that's gone on live
of
recently.
Course.
So
of course.
It is the Skarner in his strongest state recently.
So once 4.10 actually hit live, there was a lot of junglers talking about how he was too strong at the moment, but it seems he's found his place just under Lee Sin, Elise, and possibly Evelynn. He just comes in right under them here. Still, very strong jungler, and you bring a lot of CC and you bring a lot of utility to your team here. And of course, very good wave clear in this jungle here, or jungle clear, to farm as much as possible. Want to see if he wants to actually gank early, or if he just wants to farm up to level 6.
That where he does have that pull back on his ultimate. Be a big thing for him as Darien here up at level 3 now, feeling a lot more confident in that lane after Kevin gave him a bit of pain early on. But look at this stunt. Is he going to land? Yes, it is. The jump will come through, and now they've got Lee Sin in there. Early flash. Q is going to connect. That's first blood. Cornex is going to pick it up. We've seen it time and time again. Cornex on Lee Sin really produces for Millennium.
And there was no ward for Darien, even though his trinket ward is actually ready, and yet he was staying very far up the lane here. It was easy for Kevin to just jump him, stun him, and then, of course, Cornex joined grind in. And Diamond, he was just farming the golems here, looking towards the level 6 instead. Now Jiri going towards Edward.
Oh, and this is a lot of damage as well. The shield, is he going to be enough? He's already had some flash, but they're going to push through. Hook will land onto Jiri, but that gives them the kill. And that will be the first one down in the bottom lane. Karnex also took a lot of damage. In fact, Nick used Ignite onto him there. Wasn't enough to secure a kill, and Millennium sit at 2-0.
Yeah, very, very good start here. Edward once again being caught a little bit out of position, playing a little bit careless down this bottom lane here. Has to give up his life for it. Diamond though, continue farming with this mid lane for a quick counter gank. Then going in to take the Wraiths away from Karnex. But Kevin now, full control up in his top lane here. This early kill, even though it went to Karnex, was very big for them.
And there's no flash, of course, for Darien, so he needs to be really careful about how far he goes up. Has finally put a ward in position though from his trinket, so that means that he's gonna at least have vision in case Karnex does come back up. But Kevin obviously playing that matchup now with a little bit more aggression. Actually, Doran's shield, Doran's blade, and a cloth armor for him. Darien actually picking up a second Doran's blade to try and put down a bit of that early lane bully that Renekton offers.
And also Kevin slightly ahead in XP here early on with, of course, the assist and also picking up some farm afterwards. If he gets level 6 before Darien, he might look to go aggressive once again. For now, he should be happy just farming. Karnex, though, joining in once again over this top lane.
Oh, there comes the hook, and it's actually going to land onto Jiri. Have they got the damage to actually finish him off, though? Jiri still has a flash available. Meanwhile, top lane was ganked once more by Karnex. This time, though, Darien was able to slice his way back to safety of that tower.
But Millennium really putting a lot of focus here on getting Kevin ahead in this lane so he can become this split-pushing monster where Darien won't be able to hold him 1v1 and will force Gambit then to send someone else up to help Darien and therefore give Millennium an advantage elsewhere. Karnex once again going towards Darien.
Oh, Darien gonna be in trouble from this one. There is a slow coming down and a flash in from Karnex. Finishes off with a Q and will even dash out to Kevin. And again, Diamond not there at the right time. There was a lot of pressure put on this top lane and obviously Millennium focusing that one heavily as we're going to see the ultimate out of Kirpia. Gets the knock-up onto Nick. Hasn't got the damage to finish off. And sure does with the Ignite. And Kirp picks up another one for Millennium.
So Kirp managed to get level 6 before Nicky. I'm not sure it was because Diamond was actually pushing the mid lane with Nick early on, sharing some XP where Kirp got all the XP on the tower by himself. Managed to get level 6 before Nick. Jumped him instantly, of course. If Nick had the Wild Growth, he would have survived the engage here. 4-0 for Millennium. Both solo laners with perfect starts, and it's just what they need, because there were some hard lanes, just looking at the paper, looking at the champions, but Millennium really getting the best out of it.
Diamond, as you mentioned before, not really put down too much pressure onto lanes. Yes, he was helping Nick push that middle lane out, but now he is level 6 because he has farmed himself up. He's got 20 CS more out of the jungle than that of Karnex. However, Karnex has created 2 kills for Millennium, and now Diamond has to do exactly the same for Gambit as he's hit that level 6 point.
They really need his help in these solo laners. I mean, Kerb is one level ahead of Nick at the moment, up in his top lane. Kevin just farming like he wants to, pick up some lifesteal now. Hook misses onto Kraton here. Of all, every single lane for Millennium actually winning now. Only Diamond being very far ahead of Karnex in terms of farm is the difference.
Well, again, Kevin up in this top lane. Vamp Scepter now in. Third Doran's Blade was picked up. They're going to go on towards Edward. Can they actually lock him up? No ulti available
no
for
flash.
Him. But we are going to see that Karnex comes around. The Q's already connected, but he leaves it to Kraton. Karnex already got 2 kills of his own. And another one and another gank from Karnex starting it off for Millennium. And again, Diamond,
yeah.
Nowhere to be seen.
Farming away, just farming away. Karnex is everywhere on the map. 2 times top lane, picked up 2 kills. Went down to this bottom lane now and gave the kill over to Kraton, so things looking very, very good for both Karnex and Millennium. And Kevin is going to be such an issue. I mean, he's going to pick up all this farm here. Millennium even going to start the dragon. There is teleport on the side of Darien. Kevin needs a few seconds before he can actually join in case a fight should break out.
Well, we'll see if he needs it. Diamond is waiting around. There's the TP coming in. Kerb will surely be able to zone them out. That's a lot of damage. And there is the dragon picked up. But Darien going to dive into the middle. Good wild growth onto them. Millennium
walks
wrapped in the back. But here comes Kevin. Diamond going to be focused on. Will he go down? Actually took the lantern away. And in the back, Renekton dies. Millennium got 2 men on low HP. They could possibly pick up kills here, Gambit. Millennium still in the back of the pit. They see the
move
over the wall.
Yeah.
Jiri's going to be caught here. He's got no flash available to him, but you know, you give it up, you take down the dragon, you get a kill. It's still not bad at all. Oh, Millennium. Took a while.
Well, so Millennium managed to pick up the dragon here. There was no smite on the side of Diamond because he actually just used it on the blue buff to pick it up for himself. So Dragon went over to Millennium, managed to get a kill as well, and then everyone kind of like, see you, Jiri, stay back and die.
His poor guy, the only one in the entire Millennium team who doesn't have any innate mobility when it comes to diving over the wall. Sadly enough for him, but sometimes
you have to sacrifice someone.
Take one.
I mean, yeah, take one for the team.
That's how it works out for them. And Millennium, after all that, have got a very healthy gold lead. We're only, well, we're not even 10 minutes into this game up until now. We see that top lane's winning on farm, got two assists in there. The jungler, yes, okay, Diamond's farming well here, but 3-0-1 on Cotton X mid lane, ahead in TS and in kills. Bottom lane is exactly the same.
Yeah, we talked about how Millennium can start split pushing, especially once to build up a few items. I mean, we know Jax is the one-on-one split pushing monster. Fizz can be the same thing. He will be able to kill anyone on the side of Gambit as well, especially with such a good start. So we might see Millennium in a few minutes just say, you know what, we're just gonna put Fizz in one of the side lanes, we're gonna put Jax in a different one and put Korg in the mid lane and just start pushing up every single lane. And if Gambit moves multiple members one place, we just take something elsewhere on the map. Still, they're looking for the items, and of course, if they can keep extending the lead by keep ganking with Cotton X, no need to actually split push yet.
Oh, yeah. Darien.
He has flash, though. He has flash.
He has flash, but is it even going to matter? There he sees the slice and dice coming through. The Q lands from Cotton X, and whilst they may not have killed Darien here, there's no one around for Gambit, and they may be able to finish off the turret.
Look at this bottom lane, though. There's a pink ward in the bush. We have Lantern from Edward, and Diamond is down here for his first real gank. Can he actually get something? No flash in Jiri, remember.
No flash for Jiri, he does have Solar Flare back up. This turret is going to go down, so it's up to Diamond now to be making an impact in this bottom lane. And there we see the Flare coming down. Good Solar Flare, but already Diamond has pulled Jiri back into the rest of the team. But look at Edward, he's been destroyed. Crimson managing to get a 1-for-1 at the end of that. The Cullin from Genja will do good damage, but not get the kill. And a 1-for-1 when it's 3 versus 2 like that is something that Millennium will be happy with. And Edward, as you rightly pointed out, died with flash available.
He had flash up. He could have backed out of the fight long, of like way before as well. He stayed in, just kept tanking all the damage from Kraton, didn't use the flash, and yeah, ended up trading 1-for-1. Definitely not worth it. And Cotton X once again up in his top lane.
Darien gonna try and get rid of the minions here, but he's gonna get stunned, kicked, and finished off by Kevin, making it look easy. And Darien, he's having one of those games, I'm afraid, for the Gambit fans. 0-4-0. However, the good... we'll forget about that because we've got Diamond and Edward and Nick coming in. Cotton X is dead, surely, from this one. He's leasing. We'll see the mobility. Actually, we'll flash there into the jungle, but they've got vision of it. There's the slow as well. And that is going to be the end of this one, surely. Flash play. That's why Edward saved the flash. And there is the shutdown going for Nick. But my point was really about Darien. 0-4-0. Usually when Darien has this kind of scoreline, Gambit use it to alleviate pressure elsewhere on the map and pick towers or dragons up from it. That's not the case here today.
But in his defense, the very first gank, he should have had a ward down, so we can say, okay, that was his own fault. But from there on, Cotton X just kept coming up to this top lane, and Darien received zero help. So he fell behind early on, his own fault, and then Millennium just capitalized on it. They kept going top lane, kept ganking him again and again, giving him pretty much no chance of actually staying alive. And he's invested so heavily now into the laning phase with his build with triple Thorn's Blade, it's gonna take him even longer to get late game items. And therefore, he's pretty much gonna be a non-factor unless he can now stay and farm or pick up a few kills in the next few minutes. Otherwise, he's pretty much out of the game.
1300 gold just in Thorn's Blade leaves you behind, especially if you're not gonna make it count in that scenario. Meanwhile, on this bottom lane, it's seen a fair amount of action, even just between the two duos. 107 CS for Kraton to the 93-94 of Genja. And there we see again, Kraton going forward, Cullin used by Genja to push them away. And now we have Cotton X actually moving in as well. I think he was spotted out by a ward that's now been cleared in the Tri-Bush.
And this is the first time in a long time I've seen a Trinity Force Lucian. I mean, we have Infinity Edge Lucian and we have Blade the Ruined King. As normally the two options here in 4.10. Jirika getting hooked out, Diamond is bottom once again.
Oh, this could be real bad news for Millennium again. The Sword looks like Sound Connect is going to be coming around the side, but will it be too late? Jirika going to go low, he's got away! He's managed to get away and Connect is onto Diamond. Hasn't got the damage to finish him off. Creighton May just have Eddie's low and Edward May fall as well. He's two kills and Jirika got away.
He survived here, Connect joined in. He saw the gank happening, just ran to the lane instantly, joined in, and Creighton once again, he's just left by himself to sit on the side and just do damage to Gambit throughout the entire fight. Jiri was the target, he survived, and then you just leave this Corki to do everything, and Connex, of course, he's so strong at this point, just joins in and turns everything around.
And I think this bottom turret may be the second tower of the game going Millennium's way. It's Kerb again playing his signature aggressive style onto Nick in that mid lane. And whilst Nick has got the protection of a Flash and, of course, his ultimate, a Wild Growth, still a little bit scary time to him. Lich Bane was done by Kerb as his first item, as we see that outer turret in the bottom lane finally being finished off. Millennium 2-0 up on that front. Plenty of gold, in fact, 5,000 gold overall, 15 minutes into the match.
They only need this mid tower down and they can actually start moving further into Gambit's jungle, but Gambit now starting the dragon here. Millennium running from the base, they're still very far away. Might be a dragon for Gambit unless Kerb can do something.
They're going to get here pretty quickly from this one though. Jerry might actually be able to do the business. They're going to go for Diamond. He's blown up. Oh, last second Wild Growth will keep him alive. They kill off Kerb. We will see Diamond go down. And Cotton X, is he going to be able to stick around for the dragon? Teleport is coming in. And there is the dragon taken by Cotton X. He will get away. It leaves Kevin, but he's got Leap Strike to get over. The hook not quite got the range. And Millennium forced them away from the dragon. Trade one for one in kills, but get that all-important objective.
Yeah, got the dragon here. Smite was, of course, gone because Diamond already died. And then both Kevin and Connex managed to get out of the dragon pit once again. Teleport was used by both top lanes. Now Darren in trouble.
Well, he's in no man's land there. And that's going to be another kill for Creighton. Rampage now for him. 4-0-3. I'm not sure why Darian was even there.
He had to ward. That's all.
Did he even put a ward down?
No, no, he had to do it.
Okay.
But then they collapsed onto him. He was like, oh, no, I'm not going to ward anyway. I'm not sure. I mean,
it leaves him at 0-5-0. Not a good picture so far this game for Gambit. 12-4 behind. Let's not forget that Gambit has to play what you may even argue a tougher opposition later on when they take on Fnatic in our last game of the day. This might be one of those matches that you, for the good of future results, have to just forget about.
Especially if it keeps going like it's going now. I mean, still, they can try and slow down the game a little bit, extend the game with Lulu and Lucian, trying to wave as much as possible. But they will just have so many issues once Millennium actually starts really split pushing or looking for these one-on-one, two-on-two fights, because again, their champions are so strong. Blade already completed onto Jax. We have Lich Bane onto Kerb here, and I'm pretty sure both Kerb and Kevin has quite a lot of gold in their bag as well. Connex going in once again.
You land in there. There's the ultimate coming out of Diamond, but Solar Flare as Jay reappears from over the map, and Nick is going to go down. They will kill off Connex, so a one-for-one there. The shutdown gold actually going over to Edward.
So one-for-one at least here for Gambit. Getting some gold back. Nick once again going down, but he did manage to pick up two kills, so he's not looking too bad. That's a 141 farm as well, the most on the Gambit side. So at least Nick on Lulu is still in this game here. He's still doing well. This Trinity Force on Genji, though, I really don't agree with it. I think it's going to delay both his power spikes by such a long time. I mean, he won't be very strong in the early game, mid game, and he won't be very strong in the late game either, or building towards the late game with the early Infinity Edge.
And that was a free tower. Nothing, Gambit doing literally nothing to stop that one from going down. Diamond on the top side of his jungle, more concerned about getting his red buff secured, and actually needs to be really careful. It will get the red buff, but Jerry and Kerb are going to find him, and that's half of his health taken away instantly. And where's he going to head? Meanwhile, on the top side, Darian able to flash. Diamond now going to try and run rings around them, but with Jax coming in, one of them is going to secure this kill. Jerry will be able to get the stun, and that means an easy finisher for Kevin.
Kevin just walks in, gets the red buff as well. Going to be even better for him if he keeps split pushing up in his top lane here. And we see Diamond actually earlier, now he picks up some magic resist. He had full armor before, Glacial Shroud and also Ninja Tabis, so Kerb did so much damage to him, of course. Now just trying to push down the tower. The rest of Gambit is here to defend it. Force Millennium to back away. We're only 18 minutes in. We have have 14 kills for Millennium and 5 for Gambit.
And if you look where those kills are spread as well, 2-0-3 for Jax. 6-2-4 for the jungle. Yeah, okay, Curb's got 4 assists and only 1 kill right now. But then you've got your AD carry at 4-0-3. Trinity 4's already done. Pickaxe picked up as well. Genja has now finished off that Trinity Force though, so that's going to give him something. Darien going to get caught out here somewhat by Curb. It may backfire. No, he's just going to jump over the wall. Darien will chase him through though. Can Curb escape this one? Wild Growth's going to be used, waiting for his cooldowns, but it's not enough. Nick will be able to pick up that one.
All right, so a little bit too greedy. Curb was all alone up here. Everyone else from Millennium, but already recalled. And Darien with his Giants build and being Renekton, of course, is still a little bit tanky and could actually survive with also Nick joining in to manage to pick up a kill here. Another kill for Nick. Looking good on his Lolo here, looking to get his death cap as the next item, most likely.
Probably gonna have to come up big for Gambit though in this game if they're to get anything out of it. As Cotton X has pushed up this bottom lane, you have Genja waiting at the side. Will Cotton X fancy his chances? Actually needs to be careful there because Diamond will be coming around from the one side. Is he going to use that ultimate on him? Keep him locked up. He will use the ultimate as Edward will come around and put down the play. The Hawk will actually land as well. And Cotton X bursts it down by the culling in the end from Genja.
And Cotton X did the exact same thing, curved it up in his top lane. He walked into the jungle of Gambit by himself. Nobody from Millennium was even close. And he just got caught out of position. So Gambit now picked up 2 very easy kills and pressuring down his mid tower. Curb is coming in though.
Oh, they're going to try and throw some stuff at the mirror as the box goes down. Solar Flare comes in as well. Where's Curb going to go? Kriton will join in. They're going to go for Edward. He's knocked up. Wild Growth won't be enough to save him. Kriton unstoppable at 5-0-3. And it looks like they're not done just yet. Jay Reid trying to chase off the
Kevin
Scorpion. But Kevin may be the one that stops him. Diamond runs off into his tri-bush. Curb not going to follow through. Already been caught out once there.
But down this bottom lane here, Genja pushing by himself. TP down from Kevin to actually stop him from getting the tower. So TP down for Millennium. Darien still has his own TP, just been farming away actually. As much as he could at least. Been avoiding some fights and just trying to pick up some farm. So smart enough by Darien.
Darien only 5 CS behind. I know he's also 0-5-1 at the same time, but still managing at least to get his farm, as is Genja. And he's sat at 2-0-2, so definitely still something to be said in this game. Cotton X actually going to spot Edward coming through with a ward going down. We've got 5 seconds or so until Dragon actually comes up. Millennium are already in position with all 5 men. Gambit going to be doing the same here momentarily.
But this is very scary for Gambit. They're very far behind. If they lose this fight here, it might be Baron for Millennium. Let's see what happens.
Oh, he's going to win this one out. It's once again Cotton X as Kevin going to get the stuns out. Diamond gets the knockup and Edward blown to pieces as Kurt goes right into the middle of them. There's the Solar Flare finally. He locks up all 4 men from Gambit. The follow through from Cotton X will get them another. Genja trying to chase back, but the Zenith Blade comes in. There's the damage and the shutdown coming out. Can they get Nick as well? Trying his best to get away. Slowed by the red buff. Where's the bombs out of Kriton? One will surely be enough. And there it is. And that is a 4-for-1 with the dragon and with a tower now for Millennium.
Yeah, so because Gambit are so far behind, they can't even fight against Millennium. And they actually managed to get a kill on Curb. But then the rest of Millennium just rolled over them here, picked up 4 kills, another tower, and a dragon, extending the goal lead over 10,000 now, 22 minutes.
It's a big total. Millennium doing everything right at this point. We're going to see Kerb actually get any Zhonya's Hourglass.
Pretty smart. He's jumping in the face every time. We talk about how Millennium wants to just dive the backline of Gambit as often as possible. So with the Hourglass, very smart on Fish. You jump in, you use everything, pop the Hourglass, and then once it's actually done, your E is ready again to jump out and you escape the fight. It'd be very annoying.
And I've got to give props to Jay Ree as well, because that Solar Flare and the chase in that fight, 4 men locked up, doesn't really get much better than that. The 5th had already escaped on the bottom side, so credit to Jay Ree doing a fantastic job. 1-2-12 assists to his name at this point. We can see then, if you look down some of the other items, that Trinity Force is not far away for Kevin. Once that Blade of the Ruined King and Trinity Force are done, I'm not sure how Gambit are going to be able to stop him split pushing.
Same goes for Kerb. He will be able to kill everyone by himself. But Millennium's been looking more for actually grouping up and looking for fights together. The last few minutes, not been looking to split push and trying to one-on-one people. And of course, they just picked up Dragon, 4 kills, so it was definitely worth it. But very risky from Gambit to actually try and stop Millennium from doing the Dragon. They might just want to sit back now and wait for Millennium to take over the map and just try and farm, because they are so far behind. I mean, even if Millennium, okay, maybe if Millennium starts a Baron and takes a lot of damage from it, Gambit can come in and try and win the fight here. Otherwise, it's simply too risky to straight up team fight for Gambit here. They need to punish Millennium for overextending just one or two members somewhere, like we saw before where Curb did it, and then connects afterwards and just try and farm as much as possible, because they are so far behind.
Also have to question whether they've really got the damage here, Gambit, to be looking at fights when you've got Renekton, who's got Sunfire, going to be going into Randuin's next. Okay, he's got three Doran's Blades, but then you've got the Lulu, who's not going to offer you masses of damage, as we are going to see once again. Jayree dropping down with a Solar Flare. Darion, the target, he's finished off by Creighton, and they're not done just yet. There's a Wild Growth to save Diamond and to get the knockup onto Kurt, but his Zhonya's comes in. Kevin dives it from the top side, and it flashes. Wow. Counter-Strike onto four men, and that is another four for nothing.
It could be the game
here.
Already.
It could be the game here. I don't see how he's going to be able to stop
it. I should be an inhibitor.
Already used his Cullen. There's 20 seconds, so maybe just a single inhibitor going to go down. But again, brilliant. This time, Kevin flash.
They can just rush Baron.
Strike against four.
They can rush Baron if they don't want to try and go for the finish. They can rush towards the Baron. Still 15 seconds on both Diamond and Nick here. Seems Millennium. I'm moving towards the Baron here. We're just going to see the fight once again. Connex going in. Time and time again this game here, he's the guy starting it. Beautiful Soul of Air from Jayree, and just so much damage on Creighton. Darion is full armor, so the Fizz ulti and of course some of the damage from Creighton will just go right through him with all the magic damage. And then we just see Kevin here, Counter-Strike, flashes in. Four members stun now, it's beautiful. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. Lock the target up, finish them, get inhibitor, and let's see if they actually went for Baron. They did.
They did, and they got the Baron as well, taking that one along with the three dragons so far. The inhibitor was finished off as well, so a commanding lead. We're looking at 15,000 gold here, 25 minutes into the match. This Millennium side looking like the Millennium on a good day.
Yep.
We all know how Millennium on a bad day looks, but so, they are so, so strong today, it seems.
Last two games where Millennium played very, very passive, they had Ziggs on Curb or Lulu on Curb. This game, they have Fizz and Assassin, which is what he loves to play. And every time he plays these Assassins, Millennium as a team just plays so aggressive. Now, Creighton might be caught out of position here.
Ulti gonna come in, actually uses a Valkyrie there as well. He does have a Quicksilver Sash. Oh, three-man Solar Flare. Here comes the Cavalry for Millennium. They get one onto Genja. Kevin comes in as well. He'll get the stun up on towards Edward. And that's another one now for Kevin on his killing spree. And Cortex is gonna try and solo down Diamond. Kirk gonna come around, throws his ulti in. Alone should be enough damage. Cortex gets the final hit. And just like that, chasing down Creighton, three men punished by Gambit.
So because again, 10 kills onto Cork here, early Quicksilver Sash, use it against Skarner, get out of the ulti and just stays alive. And now Millennium, of course, is pushing up here, looking for a second inhibitor, only one tower in this bottom lane. And also about 15 seconds on Diamond before he can even help the team.
Not sure how they're gonna hold on to this one. Lulu's wave clear is gonna be instrumental, but I think Millennium might just be ignoring this one. They're gonna go straight onto the turret, tank it between them, and now they're gonna dive onto Darion. He gets a Wild Growth, but it's not enough to keep him alive. Kerp is the one that finishes that with an Ignite, I do believe, and that is inhibitor number two gonna go down, and they've got 30 seconds until the Renekton comes back up. Will Millennium be able to finish it right here? They're gonna go for it. There's a Solar Flare coming in. Nick gonna be focused on. Actually, will be blown up. And there's a second one onto Diamond. This is surely the game for Millennium. Gonna focus onto those two Nexus turrets. Taken down easily. Nexus itself will be finished off in just a second's time. And Millennium picking up a 27 and a half minute victory over Gambit as they dive into the fountain there at the end. Millennium finally do finish off the Nexus, but what a performance.
Such a strong game by Millennium here. Cortex started everything in the early game, every single gank he did. Either a kill or an assist over to the side of Millennium here, and they just used it to snowball the lanes. I mean, Kevin got two assists early on, but then he gave the kill to Creighton in the bottom lane, so both side lanes here were just snowballing for Millennium very early. And Kirby got early level 6 in the mid lane, only level 5 on Nick, and then he went all in, killed him as well, and then every single lane was just winning for Millennium.
Absolutely fantastic performance. It started off very early as well. Cortex for me, unleashing again, coming up. Huge.
100%.
Camping a lot of the time, Darion in that top lane. We saw it went in for the gank, forced the flash, just waited in the brush, came back around, and that's how you get things rolling. Jax by the end, 4-0-10. Cortex himself had 10 kills 4 deaths, 11 assists by the end. Kreatan didn't even die. 11-0-12 on Corki.
I mean, we really saw the difference in playstyle between two junglers here, and also, of course, Lee Sin against Skarner. Diamond wanted to farm for level 6 before he wanted to do anything. Cut next early on was like, you know what, I just farm to level 4 or something, get my double buff, and then I actually just start ganking. Gank over and over. He kept going top lane in the start, got some kills, went bot lane again, and he was just so aggressive, and Diamond was waiting for this level 6 point. Once he got level 6, he moved bot lane, first gank, they end up trading 1-for-1. So nothing really worked on the side of Gambit, and everything just worked for both Cortnex and, of course, Millennium.
And J-Ree, again, I have to touch because I feel that supports probably don't get as much love as they sometimes deserve, but absolutely amazing solo flares. He was involved in over 2/3 of the kills there, and that was 30 kills that Millennium had by the end of it. We saw it constantly, 2, 3, sometimes 4 men caught up in his solo flares. Brilliant game out, Jerry.
And such an aggressive support is what they need as well to start these fights, so they don't play very passive, because he played Leona in London against Fnatic, same kind of performance. They just rolled over them, kept picking fights here, and it was him on Leona starting fights as well. So as long as he plays aggressive supports and we have Kerbs on Assassin, we see some good games from Millennium.
Well, it's now time to head over to the stage where Shox is standing by with Millennium's Kreatan.
Thanks very much, Joe. Congratulations, Kreatan, on your victory here. As the Fisho said, it seems that there's a very big difference between when Kerb is on an Assassin and you guys are playing aggressive playstyle in all the other games. Do you guys agree with that? That is the reason, or why is that, that you're sometimes very passive, sometimes very aggressive?
We played aggressive this game because our manager told us to play aggressive. Because the last game I played so passive, like I was watching the replay, I was so disappointed with my own performance. I was like, I could go in like here, do something here, and this game I was just like, try to get some kills over there and here, and it worked out because our manager is always really happy when we play aggressive, even if you lose, but at least do something. So even if you would lose and perform good like and play aggressive like this, try to get objectives and stuff like this, he would be proud of us. So that's all that matters.
And that started in the bottom lane with you on Corki this time. You lost versus Seliver early in the day, who played Corki. Was that where the choice came from, or did you just want to try it out here?
I think I played Corki once on solo queue, and I did really bad. But the game versus Seliver, I had advantage the whole early game on Lucian, but after he built his Triforce, he suddenly could outrade me for some reason, and I was like, I got a try-it, and the early game we had that advantage as well, so it was just perfect for us.
Tell me about the current meta for you, because you've been quoted before. I don't feel like I'm doing anything in the current meta. Now on 4.10, you try Tristana, Lucian, and Corki now. How do you feel in it?
It was just a lame excuse for playing bad, and I feel like everyone has an impact for a game, and if you can use your champions to his like maximum performance, you can just carry the game alone, basically.
All right, so if you ever say it again, we're going to say that you're making excuses, of course. Just kidding. Congratulations, and thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, guys, we've got to upgrade our trinkets, but when we come back, the Copenhagen Wolves take on the Super Hot Crew, and we're going to break down this game. Stay right there.
You don't remember Leon and Corki OP lane?
I do, but
you just need to go in.
People play different right now. You can't only level 2 and people die.
He was just farming the golems here, looking towards the level 6 instead. Now Jiri going towards Edward.
Oh, this is a lot of damage as well. The shield, is he going to be enough? He's already had the flash, but they're going to push through. Hook will land onto Jiri, but that gives them the kill. Cornex is going to be coming around the side, but will he be too late? Jiri going to go low. He's got away. He's managed to get away. And Cornex is onto Diamond. Has he got the damage to finish him off? Kreatan may just have. Eddie's low. And Edward may fall as well.
Two people here.
I'm running.
Oh, Darian.
Corner.
I saw them.
Go. Cool. I'm here. I'm flanking.
I go in.
I missed.
I stun four men.
Nice.
Scorner.
Keep on.
Nice. Another push. Nice. Push. Okay.